I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes wherever you may be. Prepare your hearts to hear God's word. Unconfessed sin in the life of the believer will prevent the Spirit from giving his full illuminating ministry. So I would ask you to claim 1 John 1:9 if necessary. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. For we also once were disobedient ourselves, disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice, in envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we might be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy statement, and concerning these things, I want you to speak confidently. Now, our Holy Father, we thank you that when we were in the depths of sin, you rescued us with the precious blood of the Lamb of God, our Savior. And we give you thanks and praise for him on this Lord's Day. Thank you that we can worship him. Thank you that our sin is great, but your mercy is greater, and it's available to anyone who will call upon him in faith. So help someone today to come to a true, not a false, but a true and certain realization that salvation can be theirs. Thank you that when you save us to shape us into the image of Christ, that we might reflect his glory, that he might have first place in all things. So we pause before you, admitting our need, that while you've told us to use our minds, we're not to rely upon them alone. We look to the Spirit, the anointing that he gives to teach us. So help me in these services today. May you be pleased and blessed and glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to invite you this morning to take a Bible and turn to Romans, the 6th chapter. I hope you bring a Bible. It will help you to learn so much more of God's Word. We usually take a book of the Bible, an Old or New Testament book, and go through it chapter by chapter and verse by verse. Right now, we're between books, and oftentimes I will do a series, and I'm doing a series on our new identity in Christ right now. Now, the Lord Jesus taught that every single word, every single letter, every single mark on a letter, even the tense of a verb, is inspired. We believe that here, and so I'm not here to share my opinion. I'm here to open up God's Word. And so this morning, we want to continue the theme of Romans chapter 6, about slavery, not of the chain, but of the heart. Now, it's very possible this morning that you are sitting next to a slave and you may not realize it. Maybe you are the slave. In the land of the home of the brave and the land of the free, it seems somewhat impossible that we could be enslaved. But as you know, we're speaking from Romans chapter 6 of spiritual slavery. Sometimes people are enslaved to their job. We call it workaholics, and they don't spend time investing in the kingdom or maybe even in their own family. Others, they live for the purchase of things. We call it materialism. Other people, they live for the approval of others. Paul was not like that. He said this to the Galatians, "For am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were striving to please men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ." Men pleasers don't hurl the anathemas that he just hurled in the preceding verses. Paul didn't really care what people thought. He only cared about what Christ thought because he was a slave of Christ. He sought to please the Lord. And I suppose maybe someone here is enslaved to some embarrassing habit that just seems to have a grip on you. Well, Jesus said, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Again, that's why we open the Bible in this church. And Satan wants the Bible closed in churches. And so expository preaching that we do here, that some drive an hour to hear, used to be standard practice across America, but now it has become the exception. But it is only as you hear the Word of God that you are going to be set free. So in Romans chapter 6, on into chapters 7 and 8, he deals with the subject of sanctification. Again, we have a new identity in Jesus Christ. You know, that famous Scottish essayist, Robert Louis Stevenson, wrote of two characters in his book, The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And in one that one person were two natures, and on one occasion you'd have, you know, Dr. Jekyll who, well, he acted one way and Dr. Hyde acted a very different way, somewhat of a schizophrenia within. Well, we're not talking about spiritual schizophrenia, but we are speaking about two natures, two capacities. Before you are born again, you have just your old, fallen, sinful nature. But when you have a birth from above, and if you haven't had it, you want to consider that and ask God to help you to see your need for it, because unless you're born twice, you'll never go to heaven, and you'll never experience the life that God created you for. We're not talking about religion. We're talking about a spiritual birth from above. But when you have it, you now have a new capacity. And so we're looking this morning further about a slavery that brings freedom. I hope you brought a Bible. We want to begin in verse 15 where we left off last time. Follow along. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? May it never be. Do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or of obedience resulting in righteousness? But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed. And having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. I'm speaking in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, resulting in further lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, resulting in sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Therefore, what benefit were you then deriving from the things which you are now ashamed? For the outcome of those things is death. But now, having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you derive your benefit, resulting in sanctification and the outcome eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let me refresh you with the context. Romans divides into three sections: the doctrinal section 1 through 8, the national section 9 through 11, and the applicational or practical section 12 through 16. We're in the doctrinal section, and each section in turn divides into three sections. And so he deals with three principal doctrines: the doctrine of condemnation, the doctrine of justification, and the doctrine of sanctification. It's not until we understand the bad news do we see our need for the good news. When we are justified, not on the basis of what we do, but on the basis of a finished work. But once you receive that finished work, a new process begins where God wants to shape you into the image of His Son. And so as believers in Christ, we have the Holy Spirit of God to help us in that whole process. This is called sanctification. We will never reach sinless perfection until justification and sanctification intersect. That's called glorification in the New Testament. And so in chapter 6, he wants us to understand the plan of sanctification. Just as you know the plan of justification, that you're not saved by human merit, and if you think for one second that one work you've done or might do will help save you, you're still lost. Doesn't matter if you think you're 100% certain, as I spoke to people yesterday giving me that answer, but with a false assurance. But just as you know the plan of justification, it's essential we know the plan of sanctification. And we saw that to help us to understand that, he gave us three principal words: to know, to consider, and to present. Again, look at Romans 6 and verse 6, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with so that we should no longer be slaves to sin. That is, we have a new capacity when we are born again, where sin no longer has to reign over us because its power, its mastery, was reckoned with at the cross. Now, you can let it reign over you, and Paul recognizes that. That's why he's telling us these truths. But we don't need to drag it around, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him. If you have the NAS out in the margin, it says our old man, and some English translations put it that way. In other words, he's describing what we were like before we were saved, what we were like in Adam. But the newer translations say our old self because it's a generic word, man, here, not specifically the male gender. And so that women understand they're included, he says old self. Knowing this, our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with. See that word, done away with? Some Bibles say made powerless, as in the margin of the NAS, or abolished, as in the CSB, or brought to nothing, or destroyed in the King James. It doesn't mean annihilated. It means that its authority over you was rendered insignificant. It was rendered inoperative. And so we now have a choice that we didn't have before. And God doesn't want us, as we'll see later on, to feed that old man. He doesn't want us to spark it into action. But he wants us to know, he wants us to realize that it is now inoperative in terms of us being its servant. And so verse 7, if you'll notice, for he who has died is freed from sin, not free to sin, as Paul's accuser said of him, but freed from sin. In other words, we no longer have to be its slaves. So don't ever say, I will never change. I will always be like this. When you think that way, you're like putty in the devil's hand. He's won a victory over your life. Now, God rendered that old man powerless, and he wants us to know that. That's part of the gospel concerning the plan of sanctification. And so look at verse 11. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Consider or count or reckon. It's a mathematical term, legizomai. Just like 2 plus 2 equals 4, you know that, and you reckon it to be true. Even so, consider legizomai. Consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. So Paul is saying, you know the truth, now think the truth and let that truth rewrite the way you think. And so according to verse 11, we are to consider ourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. The secret to a holy life is not how you feel, but what you know and in turn believe. And the fact that you are dead to sin and alive to Christ is something the enemy does not want you to know. How do you know that you're not headed to hell? How do you know that you are righteous in the sight of an absolutely holy God? How do you know that heaven is definitively your home? Well, you can know that if by faith you reckoned it, you considered it to be true, where there was a point in your life where you understood that. And of course, in the doctrine of justification, understanding always precedes genuine faith. That's why we have such a shallow gospel where people are told to invite Jesus into their heart. Don't ever use that in your testimony. It doesn't communicate, and it's not accurate. It's not biblical. Oh, I've committed my life to Christ, or I've accepted him. And we use all these little catchphrases with no definition, and we wonder why people don't really get saved. But just as you reckon something to be true in justification based on a body of knowledge, even so there's a body of truth that God wants us to reckon to be true. And so it starts with learning and knowing and then applying it to our lives. So the first instruction we had concerned knowing, a new realization. And three times over, he underscores that word. And then the second word was consider. And it's a word that deals in the emotional realm, where there's a heartfelt acknowledgement acknowledgement of it. And then the third word that we looked at and examined is equally important, and it concerns the will. And so you'll notice verse 12, it begins with the word therefore. In other words, he's bringing what he has been teaching in these first 11 verses to a conclusion. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey its lusts. Unlike sanctification that happens in a moment's time, unlike justification that happens in a moment's time, sanctification happens over a period of time. It is a process. And so the third key word, which we studied last time if you were here, is found in verse 13. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present, there it is again, present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Three key words: know, consider, or present, or know, reckon, and yield, depending on your Bible translation. In other words, Paul is helping us how it is that we can live a different holy life. And critical to it is presenting ourselves to the Lord. The key to change, to character development, is doing the right thing over a long period of time. Presenting ourselves with right choices, where we say, God, my lips are your lips. My tongue is your tongue. My hand, my mind, my eyes, they are yours. I present them to you as instruments of righteousness. So again, here in Romans 6, it's essential, just as we know the plan of justification, we must know the plan of sanctification. Paul will say to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 15:57, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Christ Jesus our Lord. Some Christians don't feel any victory this morning. They feel more like a victim rather than a victor. And God wants us to think differently. Now, that's all by way of review. I spent three messages on that, 3.5 hours. You might want to go back and consider it if you're here for the first time. Download the Search the Scriptures app at the App Store. Okay, with that said, I want you to notice 3 points that Paul wants us to walk away with in this second paragraph. First, he states a principle about slavery in verses 15 and 16. Then he contrasts two kinds of slavery in verses 17 through 20. And then finally, third, in verses 21 to 23, he brings his argument to a conclusion. So let's first consider God's presentation of two slaveries. Beginning now in verse 15, he introduces us to the final paragraph. And interestingly, this final paragraph in this chapter begins the same way the first paragraph began. He essentially asks the same question that he asks in verse 1. Remember verse 1. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may increase? Now in similar fashion, notice in verse 15. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? It's the same question. And his response in verse 15 is identical to what he said in verse 2. May it never be, mega noita. In trying to capture the emotion of the phrase, it's a very strong admonition. Different Bibles will render it absolutely not, of course not, not at all, by no means. Perish the thought, don't be ridiculous, or the King James, God forbid. Some of the paraphrases, as we've noted, will say, no, we should not. The Living Bible simply says, of course not. The Phillips translation says, what a ghastly thought. Shall we sin that grace may increase? That would be a perversion of grace. So Paul here in verse 15 has rewound the tape. He goes back to what he said in the start of the chapter. And again, he answers it, this time with a significant change in emphasis. In the first 14 verses, the focus was on our union with Christ, our identity with Christ. Now in the verses 15 to 23, his emphasis is on our slavery to God. And then if you will notice, in both paragraphs, after the question and the response, may it never be, comes a second identical question. Do you not know? Notice back in verse 3, he asks, or do you not know? that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death. And we saw the word baptized has nothing in this context to do with water, but the Spirit's baptism, when you're born again, you are brought into the body of Christ. In the same way, verse 16, he asks, do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves or obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey? So it's important that we get this parallel thought is brought into our minds. Again, we're completely identified with Jesus. When he died, we died with him. When he was buried, we were buried with him. When he was raised, we were raised with him. So positionally speaking, Paul can say, you're seated with Christ in the heavenly places this morning. You say, I think I'm seated here in Community Bible Church. But positionally, in God's mind, you're as good as seated in the heavenly places. Well, just as Christ's death dealt with the penalty of sin, his death dealt with the power of sin. And so I want you to see this new emphasis here in verse 16. The key principle in verse 16 is this principle of obedience. Do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or of obedience resulting in righteousness? So here's the principle. Obedience results in a slavery. Let me say it again. Obedience results in a slavery. Now remember that when you obey the impulses of the old nature, you're not simply sinning. You're developing a habit. You're developing a character. You are yielding to a different slavery. For instance, you go home and you watch some sensual movie on the television, or you read some romance novel, you listen to some filthy sitcom, and what does your sin nature say? Your sin nature says, I enjoy it. I want that. And what does it say? It says, I want more, because the wages of sin is more sin. And so this slavery grows and it deepens. Likewise, when you choose righteousness, because first you know you have a choice, and then you consider or reckon it to be true, and then by presenting or yielding yourself to that obedience, you start a new habit through continued obedience. So your old self, your old man, your flesh, your sin nature, however you want to describe it, says, go ahead and watch that sensual movie. Doesn't really matter. You're saved. You're headed towards heaven. You're not under law. You're under grace. God will forgive you. But then you realize and reckon it to be true that you no longer have to follow that prompting of the flesh. And you present yourself to God. You look to him. You believe his promise. You've hidden scripture in your heart. We'll come to that later in this series. Jesus counters temptation each time. It is written, it is written, it is written. And you rely upon the Holy Spirit. And what happens? You become a slave of obedience. Hold your finger here and turn to Proverbs chapter 5. I want to illustrate this truth. Go to the book of Proverbs. If you're new to the Bible, you can just find Psalms, which is about dead center, and then flip over to the next book, Proverbs. There's 31 chapters in Proverbs, one for every day of the month. Some of you were in this chapter earlier this week. Proverbs chapter 5, where Solomon gives an illustration of this truth. In Proverbs 5, he's reminding us of the same truth that Paul is echoing here in Romans 6, that you become a slave of the one whom you obey. Notice how chapter 5 opens. He says, my son, give attention to my wisdom, incline your ear to my understanding, that you may observe discretion and your lips may reserve knowledge. There are families today that are falling apart all across America for a lack of wisdom or understanding or discretion or knowledge. Look at verse 3. For the lips of an adulteress drip honey, and smoother than oil is her speech. Now, it's interpreted by the Song of Solomon in the fourth chapter. When he speaks here of an adulteress whose lips drip with honey, he's not speaking of her kisses. He's speaking of her words. Sweet talk or flirtatious words are only to be between a husband and a wife. Many a man has been seduced by the sweet talk of a woman. Solomon is speaking here to his son. If he was speaking to his daughter, he would have given you the man's line. Most immoral relationships don't simply start in the physical, unless someone is so enslaved to sexual sin. Two people, they just jump into bed with each other. Most of it starts with flirting words that will later lead to the physical. And people will rationalize immorality in our day. How could anything so wonderful be so wrong? But Solomon warns in the 20th chapter of Proverbs, bread obtained by falsehood is sweet to a man, but afterward his mouth will be filled with gravel. So Solomon here in Proverbs 5 is telling his son to spend some time getting wisdom, understanding, and knowledge, which is one of the key reasons why we need to spend time alone with God and in His presence. In Proverbs 6, turn over there for just a second, Proverbs 6, well, don't lose 5. In Proverbs 6, he says in verse 20, my son, observe the commandment of your father, and do not forsake the teaching of your mother. Bind them continually on your heart, tie them around your neck. When you walk about, they will guide you. When you sleep, they will watch over you. And when you are awake, they will talk to you. For the commandment is a lamp, and the teaching is light, and reproofs for discipline are the way of life, to keep you from the evil woman, from the smooth tongue of the adulteress. There it is again. Nothing will protect you more than packing your heart with the Word of God each day. Every now and then we hear of some pastor, some Christian leader who has fallen into sexual immorality, and people say, well, look how far he fell. Really, the truth is how low he had been living all along. There's a process that leads up to immorality. He didn't fall very that far. The problem was he had failed to keep his heart close to the Lord. Now look here again in Proverbs 5 in verse 4. He says, but in the end, this adulteress, in the end, she is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lay hold of Sheol. What a deadly power sexual immorality has. It's often said that immorality fascinates and then it assassinates, and that's true. The text says her feet go down to death. That's what this sin brings, death. Death to joy, death to purity, death to a marriage vow, death to happiness, death to holiness, death to a home, spiritual death, sometimes physical death, and if unforgiven, eternal death. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lay hold of Sheol. Now, Sheol in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew and the Greek translation of the Old Testament, which is what most Jews read in the first century, we call that the Septuagint. The word Sheol is rendered Hades. It simply meant the place of the grave. And there were two compartments to Sheol or to Hades. There was righteous Hades. Now today when you use the word Hades, we think of it only in a negative way because righteous Hades no longer exists, but it did in the Old Testament. It was called paradise. It was called Abraham's bosom. And those who lived in Solomon's day who were righteous, who were saved through their faith in the Messiah who would come, when they died, they went to Abraham's bosom. They were awaiting the death and resurrection of Christ. And so when Jacob hears of the alleged death of his son Joseph, because Joseph was not dead as he thought, he was serving as the prime minister of Egypt, the Bible tells us in Genesis 37, then all his sons and all his daughters arose to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. He said, surely I will go down to Sheol in mourning for my son. So his father wept for him. Jacob was not going to die and go to a place of torment. He knew he was going to go to righteous Sheol, where the righteous dead went. But there's also a place of the unrighteous dead where the lost went. Here's a slide from our Revelation series to remind you of some of the names that are used. There's the word Sheol. There's the word in Greek, Hades. Also a place of judgment, Gehenna, the Valley of Gehenna outside of Jerusalem. It's many times just rendered hell. The lake of fire, eternal punishment, the second death. These are all terms that are used to describe the place of eternal judgment. And so if you remember in the Old Testament, when Korah and Dathan and Abiram led that rebellion against Moses, Numbers 16:30 says that God literally opened up the earth and they went down alive into Sheol or into Hades, if they were reading the Greek. Now, synthesizing different passages together that we won't do this morning, but we cover in the Revelation series, we know that when Christ ascended into heaven, he emptied out righteous Sheol. It no longer exists, though it does carry one name, one parallel name, and that is paradise. And so today, to be absent from the body is to be immediately present with the Lord. That couldn't happen in Old Covenant times because in time and space, Jesus had not yet paid for sin. Now, with that said, verse 5, her feet go down to death, her steps lay hold of Sheol. Now, the King James doesn't interpret it. They translate it, it interprets it. And it says her feet lay hold of hell. But that's what the context is referring to, the place of the unrighteous dead. And this is a sin that I think is worth illustrating today because the Bible teaches in the end of time, in the last of the last days, and we know we are in that time frame because in the end of time, God would put Israel back in the land. Most Christians are asleep to what's happening. And two aspects of immorality would grow and deepen and broaden. One is heterosexual immorality, and the other is homosexual immorality. And so we need to listen. Look at verse 7. Notice his exhortation. Now then, my sons, listen to me and do not depart from the words of my mouth. Listen to God's wisdom because you will become the slave of the one whom you obey, to quote Paul. And so respond to this exhortation. Keep your way far from her. And do not go near the door of her house. I hope every man in this church is listening to this. You say, well, Pastor, I have a good marriage. Pastor, I'm single and I've lived a pure life. Pastor, I don't think I need to worry about this. Oswald Chambers, who I've quoted many times over the last 35 years, said, an unguarded strength is a double weakness. Let him who thinks he stands be careful lest he fall. If you ever get to the point where you think you're so strong, so infallible, so unsusceptible to this, then you're tempting the devil to tempt you. Keep your way far from her. Do not go near the door of her house or the door of her website or the door of her television program or however it may express itself. Don't walk past her house. Don't flirt with this temptation. Why? Because you become a slave of the one whom you obey. Paul said to Timothy, now flee from youthful lusts and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace with those. So there's a negative aspect, flee, and there's a positive aspect, pursue. Some of you are at home today when you could be here. You're in disobedience because you could be here. Pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace with those who call upon the name of the Lord in a pure heart. So you just saturate your absence from this sin. You don't go to places, barrooms and clubs and websites and linger and hang around. Notice the warning in verses 9 and 10. Lest you give your vigor to others and your years to the cruel one, lest strangers be filled with your strength and your hard-earned goods go to the house of an alien. The price of infidelity is high. All that you worked for, your zeal, your vigor, that you used to provide for your family, your hard-earned goods, go to an alien, a stranger. They weren't meant for him. As you know, many of you, I was the director of executive ministries in Dallas, and I worked with one prominent businessman who fortunately came to Christ, but sadly, before he came to Christ, he started flirting with a woman who was very attractive. And he had an adulterous relationship with her, and he lost everything. He lost his reputation. He lost his precious wife. Before long, his children were calling someone else daddy. That's all part of immorality. It drains you. It also diseases you. Notice, and you groan at your latter end when your flesh and your body are consumed. Our society is littered with STDs, or now they call them, I guess, STIs, where there's no cure for many of them, where antibiotics won't solve the problem. And our government, I'm reading right off the government website, the CDC estimates that we are spending approximately $26 million on new STIs in 2023, with young people aged 15 to 24 accounting for nearly half of all these new infections. Billions of dollars of your tax money they're spending on this. And yet the cure is so simple. A closed system. God designed sex to be a closed system between one man and one woman. And you won't get this disease. Just obey the book. Live by the design of the designer. Your body will remain healthy in this realm. Look at verse 12. You say, how I have hated instruction. This sin's going to disappoint you. How I have hated instruction, and my heart spurned reproof, and I have not listened to the voice of my teachers, nor inclined my ear to my instructors. I fear that some listening to me today will later say, why didn't I listen to my pastor? Why didn't I obey the word of God? Immorality, it promises you freedom, but in the end, it enslaves you. One paraphrase says, oh, why wouldn't I take advice? Why was I so stupid? Satan always tries to make this sin attractive. Verse 14 says, well, in the end, disgrace you. I was almost in utter ruin in the midst of the assembly and the congregation. The Living Bible says, for now I must face public disgrace. You can hide this sin for so long, but sooner or later, people find out. And even if somehow they never know, God knows. And so as we've been reading in Romans 6, there's a slavery to it. Let's keep reading here, verse 15. Drink water from your own cistern and fresh water from your own well. That's not only true in the physical realm, but that's true in the emotional realm. Men today are driven by drugs because they perverted through the things they put in through the eye gate, things that God never intended for us to put in through the eye gate. Drink water from your own cistern and fresh water from your own well. Should your springs be dispersed abroad, streams of water in the streets? Let them be yours alone and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth as a loving hind and as a graceful doe. Let her breast satisfy you at all times. Be exhilarated always with her love. Don't get the idea that if you obey God's law, you're going to miss out. The problem is if you don't obey God's laws, you can break them, but in the end, they'll break you. God's way is best. He's always trying to protect us. He's always trying to provide for us. I tell teenagers, God is not trying to keep sex from you. He's trying to keep sex for you. Save yourself from the heartache, from the humiliation, from the destruction. Notice verse 20, for why should you, my son, be exhilarated with an adulteress and embrace the bosom of a foreigner? For the ways of a man are before the eyes of the Lord, and he watches all his paths. His own iniquities will capture the wicked, and he will be held with the cords of his sin. This sin has a way of chaining you, such that you will do things that you thought you would never do. I know of no other sin that enslaves in the way that this sin brings. In Proverbs 5 and verse 22, it's an illustration of what we're reading in Romans 6:16. Don't you know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you're a slave of the one whom you obey? That's what the scripture teaches. Verse 23, notice how he ends. Very similar. Obey sin, it results in death. Proverbs 5:23. He will die for lack of instruction. In the greatness of his folly, he will go astray. There's moral death. There's spiritual death. And for some, sadly, eternal death. The warm flames of lust, as it's often said, turns into the fiery flames of hell. Now back to Romans 6. Back to Romans 6. He's writing to believers here in Romans 6 who've been saved by the grace of God. And he's trying to help us to understand that sin, slavery to sin, can bring alienation. If you're a true child of God, you cannot lose your salvation, but you can sever that intimacy with God, and if you do, it will bring God's discipline. And there's people all around saying, I'm born again, I've been saved, I've made my profession of faith, and they live immorally, and there's no discipline, they're just lost. And Paul will bring that out before we're done with this section 6 through 8. But if I'm truly saved, I cannot lose my salvation, I can lose my intimacy, and I can lose the plan that God has for me. All right, that's the first point, God's presentation of two slaveries. Secondly, there on your outline now in verses 17 through 20, God's contrast between two slaveries. God's contrast between two slaveries. Notice how verse 17 begins. But thanks be to God. Paul's heart is so excited over this change of masters, it's like his heart explodes. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, and this statement, of course, dovetails the truth of Psalm 51:5, that in sin did my mother conceive me. We have this innate propensity, because when Adam sinned, we sinned in and with Adam, and so we're born with this fallen nature. We discovered that and worked through that in Romans 5. But thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed. What happened? The moment you were converted, you became a new creation. You became obedient from the heart. The second birth changes everything. And so our first slavery began at natural birth. This new slavery begins when we have a spiritual birth. And so here in the latter part of verse 17, it says you became obedient from the heart to that form of teaching to which you were committed. You see that phrase, that form of teaching? I have the word form circled, and above it I wrote the Greek word tupos. Many of you know that to be the word type. Some of your Bibles say that standard of teaching or that pattern of teaching. Outside of the Bible, the word type was used of the impression a seal would make. It was used of the imprint of a branding iron, say, on a calf, or the indentation of a footprint in the sand, or even the marks left by teeth. It was used of someone who made a mold, like we make a mold, say, with Jell-O. So what's molding us as Christians? Paul says here, the form of teaching, the truth. Jesus prayed in the high priestly prayer, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. That's why Satan wants to remove that mold out of the American pulpit. That's what Rick Warren and Bill Hybels said. It was a total disaster. They helped ruin the American evangelical church, and they have a serious facing they're going to have to deal with before the Lord. And sadly, many young pastors adopted their way and form of teaching because it built crowds. Paul will later say in Romans 12, the J.B. Phillips renders it, don't let the world around you squeeze you into its mold, into its type, but let God remold your minds from within. Verse 17 is really a powerful thought because it teaches that we're being molded somehow. And it's related to our thinking. Look at verse 18. And having been freed from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Again, you're still capable of sinning, as verses 12 and 13 teach us. But at our conversion, we were rescued from the lordship of sin into the lordship of God. That's why Paul can tell the Colossians. He rescued us from the domain of darkness. And he transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son. Two slaveries. One by natural birth, the other by a spiritual birth. So having described the beginning of these two slaveries, now he's going to underscore the development of these two slaveries. Look again at verse 19. I'm speaking in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. He gives kind of an apology of sorts. He says, I have to use human terms. I have to speak of slavery, something that Paul despised, an institution that was degrading and pervasive in the first century with 60 million people in the Roman Empire who enslaved. But he says, at the same time, I want to use this term because it helps to define with our fallen, finite minds the truth of an infinite God. He's telling us that the analogy of masters and slaves will help us to see a truth that we want to know. Now, part of it bothers him to say this, but remember what Jesus said, no longer, John 15:15, no longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing, but I call you friends. Now, are we still slaves? Yes. He underscores that throughout the gospel. But at the same time, we're more than slaves. And that's why Paul's a little bothered by having to use and restrict himself to this term. But we're more than slaves. We're friends of God. And so this is the term the Spirit of God inspires Paul to use because of our humanness, because of the weakness of our flesh, and because of our vulnerability, and because of our tendency towards sin. So Paul wants to remind us of this new allegiance that we are to live out. Notice verse 19. With this brief concession, he now says, for just as, you should circle those two words, just as, for just as you presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, resulting in further lawlessness, so now, circle those two words, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness, resulting in sanctification. He's trying to help us to understand the way to develop these two slaveries. Each slavery will develop. Neither slavery will stand still. One results in further lawlessness. The other results in sanctification or holiness, the King James says, or Christlikeness, if we were to summarize its meaning. Just as you presented your members as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, resulting in further lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness. Be just as enthusiastic to presenting yourself to the Lord as you were at one time to sin. Be as good a saint as you used to be a sinner. That's the thought behind it. Now, I wish I could say that I never had a drop of alcohol in my life, but I did in my senior year in high school. I always thought it funny when I look back, or strange, that you have to develop a taste for something that initially tastes horrible. But I got saved my first year in college, at Boston College, and as I began to read the scripture, I was convinced that the general principle of scripture is abstinence. Now, I say general principle because there are some exceptions. For instance, wine could be used as an antiseptic, and so in the parable of the Good Samaritan, or wine, according to Proverbs, could be given to a dying, despairing man as an act of mercy, much like we might give morphine to someone today. I have sermons on this, and I will say there are popular young pastors, especially in the Reform movement, who say we have a lot of freedom in this area, and that's why there's no power in their lives. That's why they rarely see conversions. Rarely do believers' baptism if they're, say, Reformed Baptists. Now, before you write me off as some rube, after college, I went through a four-year master's program, which at the time was the longest one in the world, 128 hours. They've shortened it at Dallas Seminary. Sadly, Dallas is going liberal. I hope they'll be able to stay the course. Then I did a three-year doctoral program at Southwestern Baptist in the School of Theology. So don't write me off because the teaching of abstinence, that this is considered strong drink and therefore forbidden in Scripture except for an antiseptic or as a painkiller. It's taught by most of the great theologians of the last two centuries
who were Bible expositors. People say, but Luther drank beer. Well, Luther also said the Jews should be killed and murdered, and so everything Luther said wasn't right. And so I was convinced initially. I thought, well, it can cause someone to stumble. It could cause me to stumble. Has the appearance of evil. I don't want to support the alcohol industry. Does it really glorify God in our day? And it's the chief instrument Satan uses for sexual immorality. Most adulterous relationships, as they progress, alcohol comes in. So some months had gone by, and all of a sudden, one night, I just was craving a can of beer. I went to that convenience store, and I bought a single can of beer. And I pulled off the tab, as you did in those days, and I poured it out on the ground. The Spirit of God just was allowing Romans 6 that I had been studying to course through my blood that day. And that was the last time I held a can of beer in my life. Except those that I have to occasionally pick off up on my front lawn or those that drift into the marsh behind us. I'll never forget that moment because it was a decisive moment in my life. I was becoming a slave of the one to whom I obey. Now, I know there are people who leave this church because they want to drink with their pastor in these Reformed churches in town, and that's pretty pathetic. No pastor will ever stand in this pulpit who uses alcohol. None. None have. And none will. But let me say, too, I want the best for you. And strong drink will give you a buzz when you first start to use it, and you are in violation of obeying the greatest commandment to love God with your whole heart, mind, and strength. Go to searchthescriptures.org. Two classic articles are there, one written by Dr. Norman Geisler, who's probably the greatest apologist of the 20th century, and one written by Robert Stein. You can remember it like a Bear Stein. Wine drinking in the New Testament appeared in Christianity Today in the early 70s. They'd never printed today. Both forms of slavery, Paul is arguing, give some kind of freedom. One that's real and authentic, the other that is spurious and fake. Look at verse 20. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness, or free from righteousness, the King James renders it. That is, when you were unsaved, you had zero righteousness, neither positional nor practical. And so the unsaved man is in bondage to sin. And before you were saved, there was a time in your life when you were free in regard to righteousness. We were like the prodigal son, right? He decided he wanted freedom. So he leaves home to, quote unquote, enjoy himself. And what does it lead to? A deeper slavery. And when he's entangled in sin, he ends up doing the worst thing a Jew could do, taking care of pigs. What he thought would bring freedom brought the worst kind of slavery. And in this sense, he was free from righteousness. But when he came to grips with the emptiness of his sin, he returned home and he yielded to his father and found true freedom. And his father gave him a robe of righteousness. Now, very quickly, and we're almost done. There's God's presentation of two slaveries, verses 15 through 17. God's contrast between two slaveries, 18 to 20. Now in verses 21 through 23, God's outcome from two slaveries. The freedom of verse 20 is not true freedom. So Paul asks, therefore, what benefit were you then deriving from the things of which you are now ashamed? It's a rhetorical question. No benefit of all. He mentions a word that I suppose has disappeared from the American vocabulary. Most people are not ashamed of sin. We live in a culture of unblushables, to use Jeremiah's analogy. And so there's a sharp contrast more and more today between the conscience of the believer and the conscience of the lost man. One of the greatest evidences of true conversion is that you are ashamed of what you once did. In fact, Romans 1, which we studied a few years back, we saw there's a downward spiral of the unbeliever in sin, where three times over, God gave them over. First, because they refused to acknowledge God as God. to sensuality. Someone asked me this morning, who am I going to vote for? I said, I'm not going to vote on Tuesday, and you should vote if you're registered a Republican. I'm not registered as a Democrat. I don't want to be a part of a party that sanctions the murder of innocent babies. I cannot. That's not to say I would never vote for a Democrat if he was born again, but I would wonder, why does he want to be a part of the Democrat Party at that point? But I'm not going to vote for a woman who jokes about sleeping with her boyfriend, but she has to put it off so that she can go to the national prayer breakfast. That's blasphemy. Romans 1:32 says, and although they know the ordinance of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death, they not only do the same, but they give hearty approval to those who practice them. When a nation applauds deviant behavior, it's on its last leg. And that's where we are in prophecy. And regardless of the world, what the world may tell you about sin, God says there's shame in sin. So he says in verse 21, therefore, what benefit were you then deriving from the things of which you were ashamed? No benefit at all, for the outcome of those things is death. His readers, before they were saved, reap no benefits from their slavery to sin because the final outcome is death. Look at the end product here at verse 22. But now, having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you derive your benefit resulting in sanctification and the outcome eternal life. Sanctification, in practical terms, is a consistent walk with the Lord. And eternal life is defined by Jesus as knowing the Lord. It's not just heaven. This is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God in Christ whom you have sent. It is knowing God deeper and more profoundly as you present yourself to him. So there's a freedom that Satan offers, it's shame and death. And there's a freedom that God offers, it's satisfaction, sanctification, and real life. Verse 23 brings the whole thing to a conclusion, notice. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Two key words that we want to think about that are central to understanding verse 23. One is the word wages, the other is gift. Simply said, a wage is what you earn for what you do. And the Greek word for wages is actually a word that was used in the first century that described a Roman soldier's daily food ration or pay. In fact, very often they would give his pay in salt. It was his currency, which he could easily trade. Salt was a key, obviously valuable commodity because you had to use it to preserve food. And so our phrase today, well, that's an employee who's worth his salt, really comes from this biblical picture. And so just as a soldier got paid in salt, even so the unbeliever, he's going to get paid too. The wages of sin is death. He'll someday get one big, gigantic balloon payment. We're going to study a little bit in eschatology on Wednesday night. I invite you out for that. It's called the second death. It's called the lake of fire. Sin brings the wages called death, but the free gift brings what's called eternal life. Now, most of the time, we take verse 23 and we use it evangelistically, and it's a legitimate application. But don't miss the original intention in which Paul uses it. He's not using it evangelistically. He's using it sanctifyingly. He uses it as an exhortation to those who've been born from above to live a holy life. Because God has saved us, because God has given us this gift called eternal life, we should in turn yield our lives as slaves to the Lord. He gave us something that we do not deserve. And so the question that Paul began with in verse 1 and repeated in verse 14, are we to continue in sin? It's a good question, because the enemies of the gospel today and the enemy of your soul would say, well, you're losing out if you're saved. You're missing out. You know, I had a young person who came recently to meet the pastor, and he said, now, if I become a Christian, I think a lot of my friends are going to hate me because they're doing this, and on went the list. I said, yeah, they will. You have to choose. And Satan will try to make you think you're being ripped off. Did God really say, Why not continue in sin? You're under grace. God will forgive you. And with a sense of outrage, Paul says, meganoita, may it never be. How can we apply this? Three questions I want to ask by application. Number one, am I truly free? Jesus Christ, when speaking to some of the religious leaders of his day, he said, you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. The Bible teaches that if you're saved, that Christ has bought you out of the slave market of sin, and you now belong to him as his slave. And so you might be asking, well, what benefit is that? What advantage is it of being a slave to God rather than being a slave to sin? And if you're asking that question, it just means you've never been saved. Again, Paul will answer that for us before we're done with this series. So how do we define freedom? Freedom is not total autonomy. It never is. Freedom is not a license to do whatever you want. Freedom is the ability to do that which you ought to do. No one has total autonomy. If I take my fist and hit your face, my freedom has stopped when it hits your nose. I'm not supposed to do that. So biblically, freedom is slavery to the right master, in this case, the Lord Jesus. And because God has saved me from death, I want to obey him, whatever the cost. Secondly, I would ask this question, if I am truly free, then why do I struggle with sin? If I'm truly free, why do I struggle with sin? Why do we still struggle with sin? Well, let me give some practical reasons. Number one, we like it. That's what makes temptation temptation. If we did not like sin, we would not be tempted to commit sin. Temptation is tempting because it's tempting, and if something's not tempting, it's not a temptation, right? Hebrews speaks of Moses, who was willing to put up with the ill treatment with the people of God rather than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. So don't ever tell people that there's no pleasure in sin. There is in your flesh. But it's only for a season. And in the end, you'll be ripped off. Sometimes we just prefer sin, or we redefine it in our day. So, you know, adultery is just two consenting partners. Homosexuality is just the way God made me. And we redefine sin. Or we call sin by something other than what it is. Well, I made a miscalculation. It was an unfortunate decision. Well, it certainly was, but it was offensive to a holy God. And so like Joseph, when we are tempted, we ought to be able to say, how then could I do this great evil and sin against God? Third and finally, does my life give any evidence that I am a slave of Christ, that I am Christ's slaves? One of my professors in seminary was telling our class story of day. He was walking down the street in Los Angeles, and a man was coming towards him and had a sign hung around his neck, I am a slave of Christ. And he thought, I probably should have spoken to him. He's a brother in Christ. I wouldn't have used that style. And so as he turned around, he noticed that on the backside he had a sign, and the backside said, whose slave are you? Whose slave are you this morning? For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. You have to choose your master, and if you've been saved, you need to choose your master daily. As you choose your master daily, you find character and new habits developing. You say, well, Pastor, how do I get this gift? You can't earn it. Satan wants to deceive you. He doesn't want you. If you're not saved today, he doesn't want you to be saved. He'll convince you, well, I've been religious. But there's a big difference between being religious and being born again. And if you will call upon the one who died in your place and was raised for you, he will in a moment's time justify you, declare you righteous, put a new nature within you, and give you a new capacity that you can be free indeed. Let's bow in prayer. We too once were foolish, disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice and envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God, our Savior, and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, not on the basis of deeds done in righteousness, but according to his mercy. Our Father, we acknowledge that we've been bought with a price, a great price, the sinless blood of the Lamb of God, that we're not our own, and that we should live totally for your glory. So, Father, as I've been preaching, you've been speaking and applying your word to each of us in different ways. Help us not just to be those who hear and don't obey, but help us to take some time to calculate, to reckon where we're at, that we might present ourselves to you. For you said we become the slave of the one whom we obey. I pray today, Father, for someone who's never found that freedom. They may be a member of a church, they may have been baptized, may have even made a profession of faith, but the fundamental direction of their life has never changed. And they rationalize sin, the things that they do. Help them in simple, childlike faith to call upon Jesus. For whoever will call upon his name, you promise, will be saved. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand? We'll sing a hymn of invitation. And if you're here and you have a decision to make of a public nature, maybe you've received Christ and you've never publicly confessed him. Maybe you've never been baptized as an emblem of your salvation. That's an act of obedience every believer should take. Maybe you're here, you've been saved, you're baptized, but you need a church home. We want to invite you during this time, if you have a decision to make, to leave your seat and meet me here in the front. Will you come right now?